Welcome back to Derivatives and Risk Education. In our previous lesson, number 11, we talked about yield to maturity. Today, in lesson 12, we'll look at bond duration, which gives us an estimate of how much the price of a bond will change for 1% change in its yield. We'll also look at the second order effect of bond convexity and why it is great for bondholders. As for most lessons, a Google Sheets file is attached with all the calculations. Anyone can access this, and you can download it as an Excel file if you prefer. Now, when you hear the word duration, you might naturally think of time. In the context of bonds, one way to understand duration is as the weighted average time until you receive the cash flows from the bond, the coupon payments, and the return of your principal at maturity. This intuitive idea of weighted average time to receive a bond's cash flows is formalized by a measure called Macaulay duration. The formula for this can be quite intimidating, so we'll look at a numerical example first. Let's consider a bond with a maturity of 2 years, a coupon of 4% paid annually, and a yield to maturity of 5%. If the face value is 100, cash flows are a coupon of 4 in year 1, and a coupon of 4 plus the principal repayment of 100, so 104 in total in year 2. So the cash flows take place at t equals 1, meaning after 1 year, and at t equals 2, after 2 years. We want to give each of these values for t a weight to calculate the weighted average. The weight we will use for a given value of time t is the present value, PV, of the cash flow occurring at this time t. I'll go through it in detail here anyway, and you can see the full details in the attached spreadsheet. If you need a reminder on how to calculate present value, have a look at our lesson on time value of money, see the link above. So, we calculate the PVs. For the cash flow after 1 year, this is the coupon payment of 4 divided by 1 plus the yield as a decimal, so 0.05, to the power of 1, which is 3.810. And after 2 years, 104 divided by 1.05 to the power of 2, which is 94.331. We also need to know the sum of the weights, which is the sum of the PVs of the cash flows, which is 98.141. We now have all the information we need to calculate the Macaulay duration. As we said, we multiply the values for t, the time in years to the cash flows, by the PV of the cash flows occurring at that time t. So for t equals 1, we have 1 times 3.81, so 3.81. And for t equals 2, we have 2 times 94.331, so 188.662. We add up these two values, which gives 192.472. And then we divide this by the total PV, so 98.141, so we get 1.961. So for this bond, the Macaulay duration is 1.961. Does this number make sense? Well, the value of 1.961 is slightly less than a maturity of 2, so that definitely makes sense. Most of the weight of the PV is at the maturity after 2 years, so the value for the duration should indeed be close to 2, but a bit less, because we do have a smaller earlier cash flow after 1 year. If you want to check any of this in more detail or try this for other bonds, have a look in the attached spreadsheet. Now, let's have a look at the formula for Macaulay duration. As I said, it can look a bit intimidating at first, but it's just concisely saying what we have done in the steps in our example. So there's nothing new here. First of all, for those who may not be familiar with it, the symbol you see is the Greek capital letter sigma. It means the sum of. In this formula, it tells us to calculate the expression next to it for each time period t from 1 up to n, the total number of periods to maturity, and then add all these individual results together. In our example, n is equal to 2. So this is just saying calculate the expression for t equals 1 and for t equals 2, and then add them up. But what do we calculate for each value of t? Well, it's the value for t times the present value of the cash flows occurring at time t, and then the sigma sign tells us to add up all these values, which we did to give 192.472. Then in the denominator, we again have the sum, now just of the PVs, for which we calculated the sum as 98.141. Note that the only difference between the numerator and denominator is that the numerator has the number of years t. So, Macaulay duration gives us this intuitive weighted average time to the cash flows of a bond, but for practical purposes of assessing interest rate risk, we use modified duration. The formula for modified duration is the Macaulay duration divided by 1 plus y over m. When Macaulay duration is just the Macaulay duration we just calculated, y is the yield to maturity as a decimal, and m is the number of coupon payments per year. Here we have 1 for annual. For example bond with an annual yield of 5% and a Macaulay duration of 1.961, the modified duration is the Macaulay duration divided by 1 plus 0.05, so 1.868. We can use this modified duration to estimate the percentage change in a bond's price for a 1% change in its yield to maturity. In our example, a modified duration of 1.868 suggests that for a 1% change in yield, the bond's price would change by approximately 1.868% in the opposite direction. It's important to note that the 1.868 is a percentage change. So modified duration predicts that for a 1% change, the price of, for example, bond would change by 1.868% of the price of 98.141. So by 1.868% times 98.141, so 1.833. Let's look at the actual price changes in our 2-year 4% coupon bond example for 1% yield change and compare it to the change predicted by duration, which was 1.833. Again, all the calculations are in the spreadsheet. When yield decreased by 1%, the price rises by 1.859. Modified duration predicted 1.833, so the price actually went up by 0.026 more. So as the bond holder, the outcome is better than expected. After yield increases by 1%, the price falls to 96.333, a decrease of 1.807. Modified duration predicted a decrease of 1.833, so the price actually went down by 0.026 less. The price went down by less, so again as the bondholder, the outcome is better than expected. In both cases, with yields decreasing and increasing by 1%, the bondholder is better off and by the same amount. So what's going on here? The reason is that while duration provides a good linear approximation of price sensitivity to yield changes, the relationship between bond prices and yields is actually not perfectly straight. The curvature that bond prices exhibit when plotted versus yields is called convexity. You can see that in this graph here. The straight line is what duration would predict, and the actual prices are always a bit above that. That brings us to the end of this lesson on bond duration and convexity. We've covered two measures of bond duration, Macaulay duration, as the weighted average time to the cash flows, and modified duration as a measure of interest rate sensitivity. We saw that standard coupon paying bonds exhibit positive convexity and highlighted the nonlinear relationship between bond prices and yields. Thank you for watching. If you found this lesson helpful, please like the video and consider subscribing to the channel. See you in the next lesson.